Process selection is the topic chosen for today's discussion. This topic has been selected from production management course belonging to our second year MBA students. According to Oxford Dictionary, the various stages involved in an activity put together is known as a process. For example, take the case of a manufacturing industry. The raw material has to pass through various stages before it got its final shape. All these stages put together, it's known as the manufacturing process or the production process. The organization has to take maximum care in selecting a process which is suitable to its needs and requirements, because it has to deliver the product in time to the market, it has to maintain the quality of the product and all these things. This concept process is applicable not only to a manufacturing industry but also to service sector. In order to enlighten you the various aspects relating to the process selection, like what are the different types of processes normally followed by an organization, what is the relationship between the product design and the process selected, and as I mentioned just now, what is the relevance of this concept to the service sector and all the other related aspects, we have two experts in this field with us today in our studios. So let me introduce first of all the experts. On my immediate left, Professor M.S. Bhatt is here. Professor Bhatt is from Jawaharlal Nehru Technological University. He is professor in the School of Management. He is from JNTU Hyderabad. Next to him is Professor Ganganath Jayanti. Professor Ganganath Jayanti is faculty member of ICFI University. And one commonality of both the resource persons is both of them, before actually switching over to the academic field, both the resource persons, they worked with ECIL, Electronics Corporation of India Limited. So they had industrial exposure also. So first I request Professor Bhatt to just throw some light on the importance of this process selection to the manufacturing industry initially.
Okay. The process selection is very important. In fact, it determines the cost of production. It also determines the volume cost relationship and so on. As a matter of fact, we have a large number of processes. We have three basic processes, and it all depends on the amount of volume, or rather the amount of quantity you intend to produce. If you are talking of a small volume, it is always advisable to go for make to order type of production. On the other hand, if you are thinking of a fairly large volume and only one type of product, then it is always better to go for mass production. So there are a number of issues which have to consider in choosing the right type of process, and without real process selection, I mean, without considering all this, nobody can determine kind of process one has to choose. So that way, I would say that process selection is one of the key factors in manufacturing management.
Would you like to add anything, Professor Jayanti?
I would like to add the strategic implications of selecting a particular process, because process decisions invariably affect your cost, your quality, your level of flexibility, and the delivery characteristics of the operations. And to the extent that once you have taken a decision on the process, you are binding the organizations, you're binding the equipment, you're binding the facilities, and any particular type of labor force that you are going to employ in these decisions. And once having bound that, it actually limits your number of strategic options that are available to you in your future. So it's just not a question of a low-level decision, process selections. Process selection becomes a very of a great strategic significance. That's what I wanted to add.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, what are the basic types of processes normally followed in an organization, manufacturing organization, Professor Jayanti?
You see, you can classify processes into three categories. First is essentially which is based on process flow. If it is based on the flow, you can have what are called line processes, you could have what are called intermittent processes, you could have what are called project processes. Now, based on from the customer's perspective, it can be made, the process could be on a made-to-stock basis or in a custom-built or custom-to-order, made-to-order basis. So these are basically six cross-classifications which are possible. Let's briefly look at some of the characteristics of these processes. Let's take up the line process, for instance. If you take up the line process, typically a line process is one which is highly, where the entire sequence of operations is dictated by the product itself. Okay. Typical examples would be mass production. Here again, you have two categories. You have what are called mass production items. Typical examples are an automobile industry. Or you could have a continuous production. Typical examples here would be paper, or you could think of an oil refinery, where the product itself is not discrete. It's a continuous flow. So this is one way of categorizing the process. The second category of products is what we call as intermittent line, where the product is manufactured in batches. So the flow is on an intermittent basis. So it doesn't flow continuously. You take up a product and then the thing is processed. Then once again, a second product is taken. This kind of a production is called intermittent production. So here, what happens is all your machinery, your equipment, etc., are organized according to the functions they perform. So this kind of a layout that needs to support this kind of a support is what we call as a functional layout or a process layout, is what is used in this process. The third one is what we call as a project layout, where it's a unique kind of a product. So that kind of a thing is where you typically you're talking about a construction of a house site. So that is a project flow kind of a process. Now, from the customers, now let's look at it from the customer's perspective. If you look at it from the customer's perspective, you can have processes which are made to stock. There, the performance measures or performance levels by which you are going to measure this process is the efficiency with which you are converting it, utilization, and the kind of service levels that you are giving to the customer, and the levels of inventory you are managing. On the other hand, if you are talking of made to order situation, there the entire focus is on ensuring that the product is delivered on time to the customer. So basically, when you combine all these things, you have six varieties of process, 3 into 2, one on based on product flow, and one which is based on from the customer's perspective.
Customers.
Yeah, that's
the line processing, intermittent, and the project approach. They are the first, they belong to the first category, and make to stock and make to order, they belong to the second category. That is customers.
Right. That's right.
So, Professor, but will you please throw some more light on this mass production?
Yeah, mass production typically is an arrangement where you have only one product. Normally, you talk of mass production arrangement where you have stabilized the product design, and mass production, the concept is it is like a flow of a river, something like a flow of river. A whole equipment, whole crew of people who work on the product, they are centered around the product. In fact, product decides the kind of layout you will have. So it just moves from one end to another end like a flow of a river. And along the rivers, you have number of tributaries coming and join. This analogy is something like various subsystems, various assemblies coming and getting fitted into the whole scheme of things. And if you look at the cost aspect, you'll find that initial cost for mass production is quite high in terms of investment, in terms of special dedicated equipment. The equipments and machinery which you have for mass production, they are totally dedicated in nature. It is rarely you find that you can use it for some other purpose. So in fact, if you look at each of the processes, there are pluses and minuses, pros and cons. So if, as I said, in case the product is stabilized, you have a demand which is quite substantial, and in fact your idea is to make it very competitive, invariably you'll have to choose mass production.
Yeah, normally this type of process, to which organizations it is more suitable?
Well, the examples are manufacturing of car, automobile, television, and many of the FMCG products, fast moving consumer goods.
Okay.
And it comes to Servicing, of course, it's a different ball game.
So I request Professor Jayanthi, actually we come across a concept like a batch production.
Yeah.
So will you please explain what is this batch production and how it is different from mass production?
Yeah, Professor Bust has just pointed out some of the aspects of mass production. We are talking about exploiting what are called economies of scale. Now, when you're doing that, you are essentially going for what is called product-focused production. That is, in this case, your fixed cost, that the cost of investments are going to be very high, but the variable cost of the unit is going to be very low. And by its very nature, these are only suitable for highly standardized products, where it's a question of a choice between volume, that is a demand, and the variety of products. If your variety is low and you just have to make one or two standardized products and your volumes are high, your best choice would be a mass production assembly line. So that is the choice that you would go. These kind of lines are very highly efficient, but as Dr. Bhatt pointed out, they are highly inflexible. You can't manufacture, for instance, if the product characteristics dramatically change, there's nothing you can do about it. Your entire equipment is now highly dedicated equipment, which can manufacture only one particular category or particular type of product. You can't switch over to another product. That is the disadvantage of a product-focused system. Now, in an intermittent production, what we have discussed, what we are talking about batch production, what we do is here, you have a rather, you won't have those kind of volumes. You're not very high volumes, which is what you really face in nature. I mean, in the actual business, where you have a variety of products, yet the volumes are not very high. For this kind of manufacturing, you don't require dedicated equipment. You require more of general purpose equipment or flexible equipment, which can handle a variety of products. And in most of these cases, products are processed in batches. That is, you have a batch of 100 of a product A, and then you maybe switch over to another product B, a third product. So the machinery should be capable of handling a variety of products. At the same time, it's not, they are not really dedicated for high volume production. So this kind of production is called batch production. That's what we mean by batch production.
Okay. So will you please explain the third category? Actually, Professor Jayanthi said it is project approach.
Yeah.
Actually, yeah, will you please explain?
But really, the project approach is not really a manufacturing decision. See, a project is something where you have a unique product. I mean, the entire set of operations are only carried out once. Let's take the construction of of an aircraft, or you're talking about a construction of a building, where you have the site is fixed. And here, what we need to do is it's only a question of scheduling your arrival of materials and your machinery to the spot at which you are manufacturing it. So there, it's only a question of scheduling your resources, ensuring your resources are available at the right point of time, wherever it's required. By its very nature, projects are very, very expensive. So you can't get high efficiencies in project-oriented kind of manufacturing.
Normally, the organizations will take the help of this PERT CPM techniques also to ensure.
Here, there are a lot of scheduling techniques which have been adopted. We have got programmed evaluation review technique, as you have just mentioned, which is called PERT. You have the what is called the critical path method techniques.
CPM.
And there are Gantt control charts and things like that, which are adopted for scheduling and managing projects.
So, Professor, but will you please throw some more light on the other two varieties, actually, Professor Jayanthi said, that is make to order and make to stock.
Yeah. In fact, this make to order kind of production is one of those earliest kind of production technique, I would say, because you know, you look at our humble tailor or a beauty parlor or any of this setup where you find the person attends to a customer at each time. In fact, the earlier concept of production, this artisan approach is also one way of talking of make to order kind of production. Now, make to order kind of production gives you a lot of flexibility. Each one is different. Each item is different from the other. In fact, there is no homogeneity.
That's the requirement of the customer actually.
Yes. And also, you don't require much of equipments. In fact, you require very, very simple equipment.
And today, I think everybody is talking about designer's choice. Can we put it that way?
No, that is slightly different. You know, designers, Yeah, I mean, see, designers, the present concept of designers' choice is very different from what it was few years ago. So, that's where we talk of mass customization, which is quite different. We have moved a long way from make to order to mass customization.
So, will you please throw some more light on these two aspects, the make to order and?
Made to order, let's take the made to order, which just Professor Butt has just pointed out on the made to order situation. You see, what is the global scenario right now? What is happening is the customer is becoming more and more demanding in terms of the characteristic features that have to be made. He dictates what has to be delivered, when it has to be delivered, and as per his requirements. So, by perforce, companies are forced to move into a made-to-order situation. They can't have standardized made-to-stock situations anymore. Customers have become very demanding as far as the characteristics of the product are concerned. Now, if you want to change your entire manufacturing process from a made-to-stock situation, which doesn't exist anymore, you need to switch to made-to-order. It requires dramatic changes in the way you capture your customers' requirements, the way you are designing your processes, the flexibility, the degree of responsiveness, all these things will have to change when you're talking about a made-to-order situation. That is the problem with made-to-order. Because there, your performance is not going to be measured in terms of efficiency and utilization. Your ability to quickly respond to a customer's requirements, capture it, and have the necessary flexible processes in order to deliver a product to customer on time. So these are the complications which are on made to order. Whereas made to stock situations, I think, are slowly disappearing. You do not have the made to stock situations. Even in standardized products, you take even automobile industry or you take motorbike industry, now companies have to design, have to talk in terms of providing at least various models have to be provided. The volumes are not as large, but when you put together, volumes are large. Therefore, the kind of manufacturing processes and the technologies which have evolved are there to support this kind of a wide variety of products and low volume, for which batch production is suited,
but
which
FMCG, is a made-to-order. FMCG organizations, actually, which model you suggest? Which type of process?
FMCG still go by mostly mass production, to some extent batch production. In fact, I don't think they have come to a stage where you can have mass customization or make-to-order. By and large, the FMCG industry, they work on a lot of volume. Volume is very important consideration.
Yes.
And even the cost has to be brought down drastically, and because competitiveness is very, very, in fact, it's a key factor for all FMCG. So therefore, you find that it's a mixture of mass as well as batch production. There are certain example where to some extent you can say that mass customization also is coming to play, namely make to order. I would give example of Levi's jeans. In fact, it was one of the companies which talks of mass customization. The idea is very simple. The requirement of each of the customer in terms of his specific measurement is taken and captured, and then it is passed on to main manufacturing center. In fact, when you talk of mass customization, it's not exactly really make to order in the conventional sense. You have a certain prefabricated or pre-made items which covers, which is half-baked item, and from there you try to do customization. So partly it is what you call mass production or batch production, and from there, from whatever has been made already, you have certain modules. You can talk in terms of modules or semi-finished items, which are almost common. And from there, you try to make it specific to the requirement of customers. If you want to give an example of catering, you have this Udupi restaurants or any of these restaurants who can whip up your requirement in a minute. You can have a special masala dosa or dosa or plain dosa or idli. But for the basic stuff, for all this is almost the same. And the semi-finished form of this item is very much available. They are not going to start from right from the beginning. So this is the approach. In case of Lewis jeans, it has been very successful, and because of the technology, it is possible to have this mass customization approach without much of impact on cost also. In fact, customization definitely imply a heavy cost. Rolls-Royce, for example, is a custom-made car, but it is beyond the reach of many of the people. Yes, correct. So that is quite different. Mass customization is a customization where you can have the benefit of your design at affordable cost. So in fact, as far as the question is concerned, FMCG still have not come to the stage where every one of us can have item as we desire, specific to our design.
After going to the market, we can choose actually whatever is available. We can
number of varieties to choose from. Yes.
To add to what Dr. Bhatt has just pointed out, the point is there is no such thing as purely a product focused output or a product focused kind of a process or a process focused kind of a process, really. Also, you have what is called repetitive focused kind of organizations. It's on one continuum, you know. On one end you have the product focus, on the other end you have the process focus, and somewhere in between you have a repetitive focused kind of processes which are there. Now, what has happened is all these things are essentially a choice between between volume that you're going to manufacture and the variety of products that you're going to introduce. Now, depending on that, you can choose or combine some of these processes. So it's very common in many organizations you will find both product kind of processes and process-based processes simultaneously existing. So now, when we come to the coming to the concept of mass customization, here the focus is you should generate the ability of producing very high volume and handling very high variety. That is the kind of skill that companies have to develop. That's the kind of skills that companies have to develop. That means mass customization essentially is about rapid low-cost production to fulfill unique customer needs. That is the basis, that's how we define mass customization. Here, the distinction between what we call as process or product focus gets blurred. Therefore, this distinction between volume, the issues regarding volume variety are less significant. And nowadays, there are a lot of manufacturing techniques which have been developed, particularly by the Japanese. They have introduced what is called the JIT systems. They have come out, and the amount of developments that have taken place in the information technology, like the introduction of CAD, CAM, flexible manufacturing systems, have made that mass customization can really become a reality. So we have slowly moved in that era of mass customization.
Yeah, will you please throw some light on this CAD, CAM? You said that they are the latest techniques and this flexi manufacturing and all those things.
Yes, typically let us look at actually we are going through some very, very exciting times.
When and how organizations can make use of all these types of techniques?
Quite right, yes. One of the biggest, I would say, influence on operations technology has been the introduction of the computer. It has radically changed operations, and in terms of not only automating, you see, you have the term that is used for substituting labor for machinery is called automation.
Automation.
Right. Now, automation essentially is not a question of substitution of labor. Nowadays, automation means improvement of quality, improvement, cutting down your manufacturing cycle time, improvement in delivery. All these things have been possible because of the kind of rapid developments that have taken place in the area of information technology. On the hardware side, you have what are called numerically controlled machines, you have these CNC machines, which are programmable machines, you have robotics, and you have other flexible machines. So all these machineries are allowing you to control the entire manufacturing process, control the quality, you are able to control costs, you are also able to rapidly manufacture a wide variety of items at a low cost and then deliver it. That has been the major contribution of some of these hardware systems that have come to the picture. Now, look at the software, and from the software point of view, you have what is called the computer-aided design. Basically, at the design level, what it has done is it automated some of the processes of designing and developing a product. When you're designing and develop, for instance, using CAD, you can visualize the entire product. You can actually digitally store the geometry of the product. The dimensioning of the product can be done. All these things can be quickly done. So in effect, what it has done is it has increased the productivity of the designer. So he's able to rapidly design and redesign the system. So that has been the greatest contribution of CAD. To add to that, you also have another aspect of CAD is what we call as computer-aided engineering. Now, what computer-aided engineering has done is, now you can digitally test a particular product. You don't have to actually physically test. You can evolve a digital prototype of a product and then test it. For instance, you want to test it for some thermal stresses, or let us say some physical shocks and all that. They can be physically simulated, and you can test the item even before it is physically produced. So in effect, what have we done? So it has rapidly reduced. Even by the time the product is ready, the designs are finalized, your final product is already ready. So to that extent, you have gained enormous amount of time in developing your products. So this has been the contribution of CAD. Go one step further, the entire manufacturing processes also have been brought within the control, the programming of NC machines, the programming of machines, the transfer machines, all these things, or material handling machines, they're all under the control of a computer. So the entire manufacturing process itself has been computerized. So this has a rapid amount of, it has far-reaching consequences in terms of minimizing your manufacturing cycle time, in terms of bringing down the cost of a product, in terms of utilization of machinery, in terms of rapidly reducing changeover times for manufacturing from one product to the other. So this kind of automation is what we call as flexible automation. It has given the manufacturers the kind of flexibility for manufacturing a wide range of products over a short period of time. So in other words, we have been able to simultaneously exploit both economies of scale and what we call as economies of scope. So that is the contribution of CAD, CAM, and other manufacturing
equipment. The latest technology actually has
some of the latest technologies which have come in.
So thank you very much, Professor Patt and Professor Jayanthi. My friend, the time is over. And thank you very much for being with us today and enlightening our students regarding the various aspects relating to the selection of a process. Thank you.
Thank you.